The Sphinx, The Life of Gladys Deacon, Duchess of Marlborough. Written and read by Hugo Vickers. Preface. It has been a privilege and joy to rewrite this biography 40 years on, one reason being the release of many new papers, the other that a number of people were breathing down my neck first time round who could have frustrated my work, and they aren't breathing at all anymore. In the archives at Blenheim, I read all of Gladys's letters to the 9th Duke of Marlborough during the First World War, aware that the only other person to have read them was the 9th Duke 100 years before. I found Gladys's letters to Count Hermann von Kaiserling in the University of Darmstadt and read them online without leaving my London apartment. I revisited Itati in the summer of 2018 with my daughter Alice, who helped me transcribe 15,000 words of letters from Mary Berenson to her mother. The National Archives of Paris at Pierrefitte-sur-Seine contained a cache of letters from Gladys in the Comtesse Greffulhe papers, another chest of gold. I visited Colorado Springs to inspect the papers of Charles and Virginia Baldwin, and more besides. I discovered Gladys in 1968, and my interest in her has never waned. I began research in 1975, talked to her between 1975 and 1977, and the book was published in London in September 1979, in New York in 1980, and as a slightly revised paperback version in 1987. This edition has been completely rewritten. Introduction. Gladys Deacon, She Never Existed. I was 16 when I chanced upon an astonishing reference in Chips, The Diaries of Sir Henry Channon. Chips, that most social of MPs, spotted the former Gladys Deacon in a jeweller's in Bond Street in 1943. He got a shock. I saw an extraordinary marionette of a woman, or was it a man? It wore grey flannel trousers, a wide leather belt, masculine overcoat, and a man's brown felt hat, and had a really frightening appearance. But the hair was golden-dyed and long, what is wrongly known as platinum. The mouth was a scarlet scar. Bundy, his dog, began to growl, and as I secretly examined this terrifying apparition, I recognised Gladys Marlborough, once the world's most beautiful woman, the toast of Paris, the love of Proust, the Belle Amie of Anatole France. Chips went over to reintroduce himself. She looked at me, stared vacantly with those famous turquoise eyes that once drove men insane with desire, and muttered in French, "I have never heard that name." She flung down a ruby clip she was examining and bolted from the shop. This story fascinated me. In a few lines, it implied a life of sharp contrasts, but I mistrusted it. I wondered if the vacant stare was hiding something. I wanted to know more about this Miss Deacon, who had changed from the world's most beautiful woman into a terrifying apparition. It is hard to explain why one character fires the imagination, while another makes no impact. On that day, she went into my head and stayed there. She appealed to me in the same way as three figures of fiction I had encountered as a child. These were Charlotte Bronte's first Mrs. Rochester in Jane Eyre, enclosed in an upper room at Thornfield Hall, and emerging with evil intent. Daphne du Maurier's unseen Rebecca, her clothes still in her bedroom at Mandalay. And Charles Dickens's Miss Havisham, in her decaying bridal gown at Satis House in Great Expectations. To these, I add Yvonne de Galais, the elusive dream girl in Alain Fournier's haunting novel Le Grand Monde. They had all had opportunities, and all had come to grief. Yet their mysterious presences still influenced the lives of others. None could be successfully brushed under the carpet, as Gladys Deacon seemed to have been. Again, the contrast between the young and beautiful Gladys and this witch-like creature was intriguing. I wanted to know how and why this metamorphosis had taken place. I also wanted to find her, if indeed she was still alive. As a result of reading Chips, I found myself consumed with curiosity. I know now what I did not know then, that I was setting out on a life-changing adventure. Everything that has shaped my later life, not to mention my career, stemmed from reading that passage, though the seeds had been planted earlier by Bronte, Dumouriez and Dickens. Gladys Deacon had been an extraordinarily famous beauty in her day, but she had faded into complete obscurity. Her name still appeared in Kelly's handbook, but no address was shown, and few people knew anything about her. But I found an address in Chacombe, near Banbury, and in March 1968 I wrote to her. In my diary I noted, "After breakfast, my letter to Gladys, Duchess of Marlborough, was returned by the official returned postal packet service, and the reason given was that she had gone away. This puzzles me a lot, though it is not surprising in the circumstances. Throughout the day, I was fascinated by her." In the summer, I prevailed upon an understanding aunt to drive me to Blenheim Palace to make inquiries there. A sympathetic, though slightly surprised, guide told us that the Duchess was a very old lady living in a small village in Oxfordshire under the name of Mrs. Spencer. The Marlboroughs supported her financially, she said, but had nothing to do with her. She was surrounded by dogs, which she walked at night, carrying a small lamp. The guide also said that on bank holidays, an old lady arrived at the palace swathed in furs and announced that years ago she had been Duchess there. She wondered if this was Mrs. Spencer. It wasn't. Chacombe was not far away. I persuaded my aunt to drive us there. We located the house. There was some activity, but we did not feel brave enough to ring any doorbells. I promised myself that when I was old enough to drive a car, I would return there to discover the truth. Meanwhile, I delved into books on Proust in the school library, found some nuggets of interest, and made an abortive attempt to start this book. My material stretched to less than 2 pages. Not until February 1975 did I make the journey to Chacombe. I again located the house and peered nervously over the wall. Then I visited the pub, which was unaccustomed to receiving visitors other than its regulars. I inquired if Mrs. Spencer, as she liked to call herself, still lived at the Grange. The publican looked at me suspiciously, evidently confused by my interest. I found this hard to justify, but muttered that she had once been a very beautiful and intelligent person and rather famous. He then replied, "No, she's been gone a long time now." I assumed that he meant dead, and my heart sank accordingly. But he continued, "She's gone to a hospital up Northampton way." He had not heard of her death, but reckoned she would be a great age if still alive. I tried to persuade myself that my curiosity was satisfied and returned to London. Then I chanced to relate the story to a friend who, to my astonishment, told me that he had once heard a story of a Duchess of Marlborough being evicted from Blenheim Palace. I checked the dates. It had to have been Gladys Deacon. This was too much. I decided then and there that I would write her life. Looking back, it was a brazen, arrogant decision. Though I started with slender knowledge, I was able to follow up the clues, and each time I started to dig, a hidden gem emerged from the undergrowth of time. Soon it became clear that no part of this woman's life had been normal. Nor would she have been so interesting, I suspect, had she married Marlborough at 21 and retired gracefully to the Dower House after his death. My task was to lift the veil that had fallen over her. The most terrifying question concerned her present whereabouts. If she was still alive, how old was she? Where was she? Was she compos mentis? Would I ever be allowed into her presence? I was pessimistic. Several people told me that there was a well-known hospital in Northampton. Eventually, this was identified as St. Andrew's. I plucked up courage and telephoned the hospital, said I thought the Duchess of Marlborough was a patient there, and asked if I could come and see her to tell her I wanted to write her biography. The secretary neither confirmed nor denied her presence, but suggested I put my request in writing. This I did, and by the end of the month I was excited to learn that she was still alive and that my application was being considered. Furthermore, I received a letter from her nephew, Count John Palfy, in which he said, The purpose of your letter has indeed retained my fullest attention and interest. He suggested a meeting. Wasting no further time, I flew to Lausanne, wondering how to convince this nephew that Gladys Deacon had had a life interesting enough for a book. I found him in his office at the bank, where he was a director, and later he drove me to his family's home on the lake. He needed no convincing. He was more than aware of the scope of his aunt's life, and gave me a number of clues and introductions. He was surprised that somebody so young, I was then 23, should wish to write such a book, and, as I later discovered, slightly concerned as to why. He warned me that I would do well to brush up on my Kaiserling and Hoffman style before visiting his aunt. "She's as cute as a cat," he said. "She'll look right through you." I came away encouraged, my only fear the enormity of the task. I put myself on a crash course on the people she knew, all of them interesting. I studied everything that I thought relevant. Then my other aunt wisely told me that if the Duchess was indeed 94, there was not a moment to lose, prepared or unprepared. "People of 94 have a habit of dying," she said. "It would be more than disappointing not to meet her." So I asked if I could go and see her, and to that end visited the office of the family lawyer, who enjoyed the Dickensian name of Mr. Sharp, to be armed with a letter. Mr. Sharp had never met the Duchess, and looked at me as if to say, "Can anyone want to go and visit her?" Others were saying, "Be careful of her, and don't underestimate her." I experienced a vivid nightmare 3 nights before the visit, in which I came face to face with the Duchess in hospital, a fragile invalid, yet restored to youth and beauty. I found myself being observed by eyes that sometimes showed anger and sometimes deceived, all of which left me yet more frightened. The actual visit took place on Sunday, the 6th of July. I drove to Northampton in trepidation. My appointment was for 2 o'clock. Punctually, I drove through the gates and up to the front door of the impressive building. Presently, the chief nursing officer, Mrs. Newton, took charge of me, and we began the long walk to O'Connell Ward along spacious carpeted corridors. We passed patients playing cards, reading or wandering about as though they were in a large country hotel. One beautiful lady, Diana Astor, rested on a window seat reading Tatler. Some made polite greetings, others were silent. The occasional hostile face glared from a bedroom, angry to see us pass. I had never been in a psychiatric hospital before and was not at ease. Mrs. Newton warned me, "You'll find her very ugly, but she has beautiful eyes." I asked if the Duchess was expecting me. "I thought it better not to tell her," she replied. "She's very temperamental, the Duchess. She may tell you she's dead. You may have had a completely wasted journey." Having travelled along a seemingly endless succession of corridors, which involved the unlocking and relocking of several doors, we arrived in the stark, clinical atmosphere of O'Connell Ward, a psychogeriatric ward on the first floor. A chirpy Japanese nurse informed us the Duchess is in the green room. Only one or two patients were indoors, the rest were out in the sun. The Duchess was seated in her chair by the door with a white linen cloth over her face, asleep with her feet resting on a stool. All I could see of her was her white hair, and I was surprised at how small she was. Mrs. Newton roused her, and I knelt down beside her. She began to raise the cloth. I saw her jaw, which was distorted, partly due to wax injections she'd taken in her youth and partly due to old age. As the cloth was lifted higher, I found myself being stared at by those eyes which were so blue that any description of them would be inadequate. She gazed at me for a moment and then cried out, "Later, later, later." She dropped the cloth and returned to sleep. At this point, Sister Dillon, in charge of the ward, arrived and said they would put her to bed because she was happier there and we could try again in half an hour. Meanwhile, I wandered in the garden, where I met a clergyman who thought I was a patient, or a patient who thought he was a clergyman, or a genuine clergyman who was also a patient. I still do not know. We had a brief conversation, which did nothing to settle my nerves. The second visit took place 3/4 hour later. We retraced the long journey through the hospital's corridors, and this time went to the Duchess's bedroom. Mrs. Newton ushered me into the small, rectangular room, and left me there while she went to find the sister. From another room there emerged a maniacal scream, reminiscent of all film versions of Jane Eyre, while I came face to face with Gladys Deacon. She was in bed, dressed in a pink nightgown and wide awake. I went over to her and gave her some photographs I had taken of her Sphinx at Blenheim. She took them, looked at them, and handed them back with the words, "I don't like them." Then Sister Dillon came in and sat down on the bed. She gave her the message that I was going to write about her, but this got no response. Then she showed her another photograph I had brought, one of her eye painted in the portico of Blenheim. Gladys looked at it and suddenly began to laugh. Then she asked for some doughnuts, which were to have jam and sugar in them. "Tell me what I'm going to dream about tonight," she asked, and then, "How's the Mississippi?" After a while, she dismissed the sister, adding, "Take him with you, will you?" My first conclusion was that she was quite senile, and I left feeling rather hollow inside. Only later did I wonder if she had not been taking in rather more than she liked to let on. I resolved to visit her again. My next visit, the following October, signified something of a breakthrough. Gladys was sitting in a corner of the lounge with her hair in a bun. She was wearing a white dress with black spots, stockings, slippers, and a blue shawl. There were flowers on the table, and she was surrounded by nurses. They had clearly gone to a lot of trouble in advance of the visit. We can hear her voice, tape-recorded on the day. It was a communal room filled with other patients. She was deaf, so she tended to shout. Sister Dillon was telling her that a visitor was on his way, a Mr. Vickers, who was going to write a book about her. I entered the room, just as Gladys was saying, "But I don't see why I should be disturbed by Mr. Vickers."
"Hello, how are you?"
"I'm very well, thank you."
"Well, I don't see why I should be disturbed by Mr.
Vickers." "Yes, hello."
I sat down beside her. Her head turned to look at me, and she continued slowly in a different tone, "And he doesn't think so either."
"Well, he doesn't think so either.
He's come to see you."
"Well, I don't like this story."
"Well, I don't like this story," she said.
"Can I show you some pictures?"
I produced photographs of Hugo von Hofmannsthal, David Garnett, Sigmund Freud, Harold Nicholson, Marcel Proust and Consuelo Vanderbilt. She had great fun denying that she'd ever seen any of them. She laughed at the picture of Proust and inquired, "Is that you?" She liked the dress in the picture of Consuelo, so we tried it again. Gladys decided that Consuelo was a consul. She beckoned to one of the male nurses and asked him if he had ever seen the lady in the photograph. Prompted by me, he said, "It's Consuelo." With much laughter, she continued, "Did you ever see a consul dressed like that? No, that's a very fine consul. I'm not smart enough to hobnob with consuls." She pointed to the picture of Proust and addressed a young nurse. "When you get married, you go to a fellow like that." Soon afterwards, she gave me back the picture and she said,
"Thank you very much. Yes. You did me a better laugh than I thought you when I came here."
"That's very kind, thank you. But that's always a pleasure."
"Thank you very much. You've given me a better laugh than I've had since I came here." She offered me a cup of tea, asked me to stay with her, and we began the slow process of making friends. Because I brought photographs, she referred to me in those early days as the photographer. 3 visits later, she recognised me and gave me a huge greeting. My visits began to extend to several hours at a time, and she invited me to keep coming to see her. Because she was deaf, every question had to be written in capital letters in a black felt-tipped pen. She often missed oral questions, but her eyesight was phenomenal and she read without spectacles. She would read the question slowly and then reply if she wanted to, usually in English or French, which was fine, but occasionally in German, which I could not understand. She spoke all languages so fluently that some of the nurses thought she was French and others that she was German. They were surprised when I told them she was American. They also used to ask about her car accident. Gladys had four tiny scars on her chin, two on each side. It was where they had cut out the paraffin wax after her injections went wrong. In January 1976, she started to address me as tu, not vous, when speaking French. And just before I went to America in March, she took my hands in hers, put them to her forehead and declared, friends forever. All in all, I visited Gladys 65 times. Never for a moment did I expect that she would lift her self-imposed ban on discussing the past. Yet in February 1976, I showed her a book on D'Annunzio and told her that I was reading it. She suddenly told me she used to know him in Rome and asked me what I thought of him. I almost jumped into the air. I spluttered out the inadequate comment, a good poet, but perhaps a less good politician. She brushed this aside and continued, he had spark, but not fire. In this respect, he was like Winston Churchill. Winston, he was not a great man. He had weight, yes, but he was not a gentleman. I knew him well enough. He used to come to that place where we were, Blenheim. He liked to lay down the law. Hitler, however, she thought was a great man. He had a telling personality. When you think how hard it is to create a rising in a small village, well, he had the whole world up in arms. He was larger than Winston. Winston couldn't have done that. She went on to describe insanity as a disease of the brain like a lock. And then she urged me to take over the hospital. Hoof them out, she said. I pointed at some young nurses. Not them. They're small fry. Once a little light had been shed on the past, I realised that she would respond to books, liked looking at pictures and discussing the different characters. Most of all, she liked looking at art books and the works of artists. Gradually, I worked my way through the artists, writers, and society figures of her day, a process mutually enjoyed and with many tangents and diversions. At the end of a meeting, which sometimes lasted as long as 4 hours, it was invariably I who was tired and not Gladys. Only one subject remained taboo unless she mentioned it, and that was her identity. She was never to be directly associated with her past. She might say, Rodin liked to precipitate himself on every woman he met, you know, hands all over you. But if I said, ah, you knew him then, she would either shut up like a clam, or say, I never met him, but a close woman friend of mine told me. And when I dared to ask her once, where is Gladys Deacon? She looked at me with a twinkle in her eye and said slowly, Gladys Deacon, she never existed. Part 1. Early Days. Chapter 1. A Remarkable Young Person. An extract from American Weekly, Heartbreaks of Society. Edward Parker Deacon advanced into the room, his eyes darting from side to side in a cursory examination that was interrupted when his wife, her composure regained for the moment, blew out the candle. Permit me, said the hotel secretary in the background. I have another candle. Thank you, said Edward Deacon. We'll see how good the hunting is in the sitting room. He found his quarry cowering behind a couch. Three shots signalled the end of a 2-year chase, and Edward Deacon reappeared in the doorway, a smoking pistol in his right hand. I suggest, he said to the hotel secretary, that you summon the gendarme. Monsieur Emile Abbé seems to be dead. Murder is a disruptive business in a family. For 11 years, Gladys had been living in Paris, travelling with her family to the high spots of Europe and occasionally crossing to America. And then it all ended. Any stability she had known dissolved overnight, and she was propelled into a new life, separated from her mother, and sent with her father to a foreign land. In February 1892, then aged 11, Gladys was staying in the Hotel Splendide in Cannes, with her mother, her three sisters, and her mother's stepmother. On the night of the 17th of February, her father shot her mother's lover dead in the hotel. He handed himself in, while her mother wrote to her hostess of the following day to say she regretted she would be unable to attend a luncheon party. Gladys and her sisters were taken away from the hotel by their step-grandmother, and soon afterwards Gladys found herself deposited in a convent in Paris. Gladys Deacon was an exceptionally beautiful, intelligent and gifted child, an American who could have walked out of a novel by Henry James. She was born in Paris at the Hotel Brighton in the Rue de Rivoli opposite the Tuileries Gardens on Monday the 7th of February 1881. Her mother, Florence Deacon, a good-looking 21-year-old, was thrilled at the sight of the baby, with its arms outstretched and its little hands opening and closing. Later, she recalled to Gladys, "The rapture I felt these many years ago when first I held you in my arms. I can never think about it without emotion." Gladys gave many contradictory dates for her birth, anything from 1888 on a visa application to 1890 on her marriage certificate. On her 95th birthday, in 1976, she sat at the head of a long table and gazed at the cake with its handful of candles. Earlier, she had pretended she had forgotten when her birthday was. "How could I know? I couldn't say, 'Here I am.'" She dismissed the matter with an alternative theory. "I was not born. I happened." Edward Parker Deacon and his wife Florence were rich Americans who chose to live in Europe, as many discriminating Americans did at the height of the Belle Époque. It was an era of respectable idleness and security, when the upper crust, le gratin, existed stylishly in the world of salons and smart restaurants, of magnificent balls, exclusive clubs, and strolls in the Bois de Boulogne. The Deacons would travel, according to the season, to Cannes, Nice, or Trouville. They might visit Genoa or Homburg, Geneva or St. Moritz. They crossed the Atlantic for the season at Newport, or to visit Mrs. Deacon's brother, Charles Baldwin, at Clara County, California. Gladys was the most beautiful and the most brilliant of the four Deacon sisters, and each of them was destined to glitter and shock in European or American society. Next was Audrey, born in Pau, France, on the 30th of November, 1883. In childhood, she was close to Gladys and frequently covered up for her mischievous elder sister, though later they fell out. Audrey possessed a more regal beauty than Gladys's. She had brilliant dark eyes and a classic brow. Being tall, she was teased by her sisters. "What's it like up there in the heavens?" Edith was born in Cannes on the 16th of February, 1887. Her devotion to her mother was total. While she disliked Gladys, who was a superb mimic and did not fail to include her mother in her repertoire. The youngest child, Dorothy, was not born until March 1891. There was a brother, Edward Parker, who was born in Paris but died young in May 1887. Gladys's first home was 14 Rue Pierre Charron, just off the Champs-Élysées. During her early years, she was called Marie Gladys, the names by which she was baptized in the American Episcopal Church of the Holy Trinity on the 20th of March, 1881. Later, she swapped the names round and settled for Gladys on its own, which she pronounced Gladys in the style of Americans such as Gladys Vanderbilt Sacheney. The children were brought up in a mixture of French and English. When Gladys was 6 months old, the Deacons took a house in Grosvenor Street in London. A goat cart took Gladys and Mrs. Deacon's dog for rides in Hyde Park. Years later, Gladys pieced together this phase in conversation with her nurse, Irma Deodat, who was with the family from 1887. "I had a very pretty wet nurse, and Papa insisting that Irma should never leave her and me out of her sight. Mama gets a lovely pale blue brocade with silver flowers, Papa very jealous, and poor Mama obedient as a lamb. Papa dislikes the cooking, and they take lodgings which prove satisfactory. They go to Windsor for a visit. Papa and Mama prefer the Otto Fitzgerald's hospitality because they are warmer there. I get cantankerous and develop dyspepsia. Papa says that Nunu, her nurse, has flirted with some footy in London during the week's absence." She was not always happy, though. Years later, during the First World War, she wrote, "I feel as I used to when a little girl, and it rained, lonely, depressed, lost in space." The Deacons came from New Jersey and were dashing figures who moved up in the world. Gladys's grandfather, Edward Preble Deacon, married a Miss Parker from a famous family of Parkers in Boston, and they lived at the fabulous Deacon House. Through her mother, Florence Baldwin, Gladys was part of a grand New England family, originally from Aston Clinton in Buckinghamshire. The Baldwins and the Parkers provided Gladys with a family tree proven back many generations. Her background gave her the confidence that she was of high birth and permitted her to cast aspersions on the origins of less well-connected Americans. A favourite expression in later life was to describe someone pejoratively as middle class. From her mother, she inherited great beauty, and from her father, a sense of adventure and a bizarre intelligence. Edward Parker Deacon, austere, dark and intelligent, had the straight eyebrows and powerful bright blue eyes which his daughter inherited. His hair was brown and he had a pronounced nose. In his youth, then known as Ned, he attended school at the Berkeley Institute in Newport, where Henry James was a fellow pupil. He went on to Brown University and then joined the 1st Massachusetts Cavalry as a second lieutenant. He served in the various battles of the Peninsula and Virginia campaigns in the Civil War. He participated in the capture of Fort Harrison in 2 days' fighting, during which the commander and 2/3 of his staff were killed, before resigning his commission in June 1865. Having profited from the sale of Deacon House and still owning property in Boston, he led a life of leisure, financed by annuities, was a member of Boston's famous Somerset Club, and frequently travelled abroad. He was considered one of New England's most eligible bachelors. But he was reserved and distant, combining elements of his dashing father with his deeply unstable mother, Sarah Ann Parker. His mother's eccentricities became a source of embarrassment in Boston society. She insisted on being addressed as Mrs. De Con, would scream at people in the street, and had a curious predilection for sliding on the icy gutter in Sumner Street, obliging her footman to await her arrival feet first at the end of the slide to catch her in his arms. In 1861, she took her family to Europe with her and eventually settled in England. After years of epilepsy and 18 months of diabetes mellitus, she died on the 18th of May 1900 at Wyke House, Isleworth, Middlesex, a large, claustrophobic lunatic asylum where nobody knew or cared who she was. She was the first of 3 generations of deacons to end their days in a sanatorium, all for different reasons. Edward Parker Deacon was fond of yachting, and it was on such a trip that he met 16-year-old Florence Baldwin, daughter of Admiral Charles H. Baldwin, the richest man in the U.S. Navy. Nobody was particularly pleased when he led her to a specially constructed altar at the Fifth Avenue home of her father and made her his wife on the 29th of April, 1879. By then, he was 35 and she a mere 20. Florence's mother, Pamelia Tolfrey, had been a great belle, a beauty of the wax doll type with a profusion of golden hair worn in short, fluffy curls all over her head. She died in 1873. In 1875, the Admiral married Mrs. Mary Morgan Reed, known as Maren, and they divided their time between New York and Newport, Rhode Island. They also came to London, where, in 1883, Maren was presented to the Princess of Wales at a Buckingham Palace drawing room. And at Cowes in August 1884, the future Edward VII honoured Admiral Baldwin with a dinner on his yacht. Maren was a devoted stepmother to Florence and her brother Charlie, though as time went on, she nurtured reservations about Florence due to her extravagance. Considerably rich in her own right, she was a close friend of Elliot Gregory, an effete society portrait painter who wrote about international society as the idler. Maren was witness to most of the drama in the Deacon family. Florence's brother, Charles Adolf Baldwin, known as Charlie, was born in San Francisco in 1861, educated at Harrow, and became a collector of etchings, paintings, bronzes, and enamels. In 1896, he married Virginia Hobart, daughter of a millionaire California gold mine operator. They lived in Santa Clara County, to which Florence paid several visits with her children in the 1880s and 1890s. Then, in 1901, Because Virginia suffered from tuberculosis, the young Baldwins moved to Colorado Springs, arriving with two automobiles to the astonishment of the locals. Virginia's considerable fortune enabled Charlie to commission the architect Thomas McLaren to construct Clermont, his home at Broadmoor, modelled on the Grand Trianon at Versailles, but one-eighth of its size. With parquet de Versailles wooden floors, the house was completed in 1907. Virginia being so rich, both Charlie and she were important in the lives of his sister Florence and her daughters, Florence turning frequently to her brother when funds were low. The newly married Deacons left for Paris on the 29th of June, where they ran into Henry James. He noted that Deacon was there, with the prettiest young wife, a Miss Baldwin of Newport, in all creation. He was amazed to find that Deacon was literary. The new Mrs. Deacon was not an intelligent woman, but she was cultured. She adorned her beauty at great expense. She was a famed customer at all the smart Paris shops, and like Eleonora Duse and some of Proust's heroines, she loved the serpentine dresses of Fortuny. She once bought an entire dressing table set in vermeil, despite possessing three of them already. Social columnists monitored her and expressed concern that the lascivious eye of the Prince of Wales had fallen upon her. They hoped she would not become one of his mistresses. By 1885, her father, the Admiral, was writing, "Florence goes much in French society. I think she is rather inclined to drop her own country people." It is easy to pour scorn on her, for her values, ambitions and aspirations are hard to admire. Later in life, she spent with no regard for the future and ran up enormous debts, scrounging on her more solid relations. Yet she survived many grave crises and disasters that would have driven a lesser woman to take the veil. "How cruel life was to her, how unjust," wrote Gladys in the aftermath of her death. Florence Deacon sought the company of artists, musicians and writers such as Auguste Rodin, Bernard Berenson and Maurice Loeb. She was a particular friend of Robert de Montesquieu, who remembered her as a likeable, worthy enough woman. It was through her mother that Gladys met many of her artist friends, but in the early years she knew well the frustration of being presented in the drawing room, then spirited away to the nursery by Irma while the grown-ups continued their conversations. Sometimes she and her sister Audrey crept downstairs before a dinner party, taking surreptitious bites from peaches on the dining room table, amused at the thought of the guests later finding tooth marks. Gladys's parents had widely differing tastes, Mr. Deacon preferring the company of his own countrymen. Due to the immense amount of publicity that attended the Deacons in the 1890s, there is no dearth of authoritative statements about their way of life. About a month after the wedding in 1879, Mr. Deacon is reported to have knocked his wife down because he did not like her hairstyle. In the hotels in which they stayed, he forbade the servants to wait on her and would not even allow a basket of wood to be brought to her room without written instructions from him. In the winter of 1884, spent in Paris, Mrs. Deacon was about to leave for a ball when she found that one of the children's nurses had gone off duty without permission. Mr. Deacon insisted that she should go on her own, promising to join her later. When he had failed to appear by 1 o'clock, she returned home to find him barricaded in their apartment. When at last she got in, Mr. Deacon was found rushing about undressed in a state of frenzy. In May 1887, their little boy died. Mr. Deacon was not in the least bit sympathetic when he found his wife alone weeping. He reproached her for her tears, then beat her so cruelly that she was marked for days. He was further accused by Mrs. Deacon's friends of intemperance and cruelty to the children. Gladys used to relate to villagers at Chacombe that he was tough to all the sisters and frequently thrashed them. In the midst of these troubles, on the 17th of November, 1888, Mrs. Deacon's father, Admiral Baldwin, died at 590 Fifth Avenue, New York, at the age of 68. His death meant that Mrs. Deacon inherited $235,408.22, a third share of his immense fortune. From that moment on, Mr. Deacon refused to contribute 1 cent toward household expenses or the support of his family, further allegations of violence were made against him. However exaggerated, the picture is not a happy one. Mrs. Deacon is said to have tried hard to subdue her husband's dangerous temper. Throughout their subsequent troubles, the couple were united on one thing only, that their children should be well cared for. Mrs. Deacon was also desperate to avoid any scandal that might jeopardise her place in society. Somehow there was no scandal, and even Mr. Deacon conceded that until 1888 his wife's behaviour had been exemplary. Only later did he accuse her of improper conduct with a number of men unknown to him, but foremost in the list of lovers was a man with whom he was only too well acquainted. Émile François Abbé was introduced to the Deacons at Villers-sur-Mer in 1888 by the Baron Edmond de Rothschild. He was a young French attaché, born in Paris on the 3rd of January 1845, and thus 47 in February 1892, a bachelor who had long indulged in the high life and a mere 3 months younger than Mr. Deacon. According to Gladys, the Abbés had Jewish blood. Émile's father had worked with George Haussmann, who had rebuilt so much of Paris, and then amassed a considerable fortune in the laying down of the Suez Canal. His mother was a Parisian who shared with Mrs. Deacon the dubious honour of being satirised by Robert de Montesquieu in Les Quarante Bergères. An intelligent man, Abbé had given up the diplomatic service in favour of a life of travel, sport, summer resorts and lovely ladies, one of whom, the Comtesse du Barry, was to assist in his undoing. He was not a handsome man, his pockmarked face and sallow complexion inspiring Mr. Deacon to nickname him the Yellow Dwarf. Yet he had a way with women, and after evenings at the theatre he would visit notorious persons of Parisian nightlife. Émile Abbé wasted no time in becoming a close friend of both Mr. and Mrs. Deacon and a regular visitor to their home. As she stated later, "My husband was quite aware of the frequency of his visits at Paris as well as at Cannes. He was always received at our house as an intimate friend." When Mr. Deacon received an anonymous letter warning him about his wife and Abbé, she reproached him for not understanding the Parisian flirt. He forbade Florence to see Abbé, and it seems that for 2 years she obeyed him. All would no doubt have been well, but for the fact that Mrs. Deacon foolishly left a letter in her secretaire which began, "My darling, why have you broken with me?" Her husband identified this as having come from Abbé, but once more Florence Deacon appeased her husband, stating that it was impertinent of Abbé to have written to her, but what could she do? In March 1891, the Deacons moved to an apartment at 142 Rue de Grenelle, in the heart of the Faubourg Saint-Germain. There, on the 12th of April 1891, Mrs. Deacon's youngest child, Dorothy, was born. Gladys was ill at the time, and Mr. Deacon found the domesticity too much for him, so he left to spend a fortnight in a hotel. A month after Dorothy's birth, a piece of lingerie reminded Mr. Deacon of Abbé's threatening presence. One evening, at about 10 o'clock, he came home from a Rothschild party to find Abbé hiding behind the curtain. Mr. Deacon later stated, "I noticed the curtains moved. I rushed to the curtain and found Monsieur Abbé, whom I had not seen for 2 years. I walked straight up to my wife and said, 'Look at this man. Now I doubt the paternity of your child.' He went in search of his stick, but on his return, not surprisingly, Abbé had gone." Mrs. Deacon claimed that Abbé had called on her because she was unwell and she had invited him to come up. He had only hidden because he remembered Mr. Deacon's unjust suspicions. She enlisted the help of her brother Charlie and her stepmother to point out to her husband that he did not understand that he must not alienate his wife's affections by his persistent jealousy. Mr. Deacon was duly humbled and allowed his wife to see Abbé, but only at the tea hour. Abbé then engaged chambers in the Rue d'Anjou near the Boulevard Malesherbes under a pseudonym. Here, Mrs. Deacon visited him, unwisely confessing to Mrs. Kate Moore that she used to swing naked on a seat for Abbé's greater enjoyment. Mrs. Deacon's doctor recommended a change of air and dispatched her to St. Moritz with her baby. Mr. Deacon's doctor diagnosed that he had inflammation of the stomach, so he left for Homburg with Gladys, Audrey and Edith. At this point, the Comtesse du Barry, a former mistress of Herbe, took her revenge, since her regular allowance had ceased to come. She wrote to Mr. Deacon several times. He became anxious. Having heard no news of his wife, he telegraphed her, demanding that she break with Herbe or divorce. He promised to be the most loving of husbands. After 2 weeks, Mrs. Deacon replied that he was a tyrant, and knowing that he had business there, urged him to go to America and leave her alone. She added that it would be better if they communicated through their solicitors in future. Mr. Deacon's reaction to this was to announce that she would be receiving a visit from him in St. Moritz. Mrs. Deacon cabled at once that she was leaving the next day and proceeded to the Italian lakes with her friends the de Grammonts. Mr. Deacon went to Geneva to consult a specialist. There, he learned from a friend, Mr. Scheffer, that Herbe had been ensconced in St. Moritz. He then established that the de Grammonts had left a fortnight before Mrs. Deacon. Knowing that she would stop at the Hotel Promontorio in Grison, Switzerland, he sent an ingenious dispatch inquiring whether or not Monsieur et Madame Herbe had left yet. The reply came back, left for Bellagio. Years of suspicion were vindicated. According to Mrs. Deacon, though hotly denied by her husband, she received an ironic telegram from him, "Have fun with your Herbe." Mr. Scheffer told Mr. Deacon that it was ridiculous to suggest that Herbe was having an affair with his wife. They were both too well known in society. In the general confusion, Mr. Deacon vacillated between fury and contrition. He wrote to his wife, apologising for his actions. Some days later, Mrs. Deacon came down to Geneva from the Villa Serbelloni at Bellagio and explained that a series of coincidences had led to misunderstandings. There was something of a reconciliation, and the family spent some days together in Aix-en-Provence. Soon it was time for Mr. Deacon to depart for the United States. As he embarked in a steamer at Le Havre, he clutched a friendly telegram from his wife signed, "Love from All." In the middle of October 1891, he returned to Paris. Once more, he found Herbe a regular visitor to his house. The question of divorce reared its head again. He employed detectives to try to catch Mrs. Deacon at 12 Rue de Penthièvre, where Herbe had a small apartment. But his plan was rumbled by an agent in the pay of Mrs. Deacon. He never secured enough evidence for legal action, despite discovering that hot from Abbe's love nest, she had dined with a young man in a cabinet particulier at a Champs-Élysées restaurant. In the circumstances, he let Mrs. Deacon and the children set off for the south of France for the winter season of 1891-1892, while he remained in Paris, deciding what to do next. Chapter 2. Murder in the South of France. Mrs. Deacon began her stay in the south of France at the Hotel de Noailles in Marseille, but early in February she moved to Cannes, where she expected to spend the rest of the winter. Travelling with her were her four daughters, her stepmother, and a small retinue of servants. A few paces behind came Emile Herbe. It is no surprise to find Florence Deacon in Cannes, which had been transformed from a simple fishing village into a fashionable winter resort by Lord Brougham, not so much for the favourable climate found there, but for the inclement weather avoided elsewhere. French and Germans, but most of all English, flocked to Cannes in the late 19th century and spent their time playing bridge, flirting, or having tea at Rumpelmeyer's on the Boulevard de la Croisette. Next door, easily spotted due to a profusion of multicoloured flags, stood the Cercle Nautique, a favourite haunt of Mr. Deacon. Here the Prince of Wales played baccarat. Here his younger brother, the Duke of Albany, a haemophiliac, fell down the club stairs with fatal results. And here the barman once counted 7 Russian Grand Dukes in the club at the same time. Mrs. Deacon engaged rooms for her family at the Hotel Windsor, one of 8 good hotels on the eastern side of the Boulevard du Canet. It was a highly suspicious Mr. Deacon who arrived there suddenly on Monday, the 15th of February. He wasted no time in examining the hotel register and was not altogether surprised to spot the name of Herbe among the guests. he demanded that the family move elsewhere. Rooms were therefore taken at the Hotel Splendide opposite the Yachting Harbour, one of Cannes' oldest hotels and still flourishing today. Gladys's friend Elizabeth, Lily de Gramont, recalled later that the hotel was flanked by palms and was a suitable theatre for a drama of jealousy because of its air of Italian opera. Mrs. Deacon chose a salon and bedroom for herself on the first floor, but told her husband that there were no other rooms available there, so Mr. Deacon, Marraine Baldwin and the children were lodged on the floor above. Their affair being long-standing, Mrs. Deacon was becoming lax in her precautions. Even so, it is astonishing that Abbé had the temerity to install himself in Mrs. Deacon's hotel. It was not long before the bright eyes and dark brow of Edward Parker Deacon were poised intently over that hotel register. Again the name of Abbé leapt from the page. Mr. Deacon went directly to the hotel office, where the management, obeying instructions, informed him that Abbé had departed. This was not the case. Abbé was hiding in a room on the other side of Mrs. Deacon's salon. He would soon find more reasons than one for regretting the absence of a communicating door. A low profile was maintained for the next 2 days, while Mr. Deacon prowled about, his mind alert to any clue leading to Abbé. Nothing happened on Tuesday night, and on Wednesday, Mrs. Deacon paid a visit to the Comtesse Melanie de Portales, one of the beautiful ladies-in-waiting to Empress Eugénie of France, herself painted by Winterhalter. Mrs. Deacon returned home tired, only to find her husband poised to discuss divorce. He wanted his wife not to contest the action, thereby avoiding much scandal. But divorce meant ostracism from society, and apart from her children, society was Florence Deacon's dominant interest in life. When Gladys and her sisters were safely in bed, both deacons called on Marraine Baldwin. At 10 o'clock, Mr. Deacon excused himself and left the hotel to attend a ball at the Cercle Nautique. A clear half an hour later, Abbé, attired in a smoking jacket, called on Mrs. Deacon. At 10:45 p.m., Irma Deodar helped Mrs. Deacon to undress and left her in a white dressing gown. Mr. Deacon returned at about midnight and observed a light shining under his wife's door. He approached with stealth and recognised the rough voice of Abbé within. He went up to his room, collected his revolver, and went in search of Paul Beaumont, the hotel secretary, who was at work in his office. Mr. Deacon ordered Beaumont to accompany him, and they proceeded in silence to Mrs. Deacon's bedroom door. Beaumont carried a lighted candle. Exhorting the secretary to follow me with the light as soon as the door is opened, Mr. Deacon knocked loudly. The response was a quick shuffling sound. In the next 2 or 3 minutes, Abbé considered his options. He could not get through to his own room, but he could not leave by the salon door into the passage, but would come face to face with Mr. Deacon. Another possibility was to leave by the window, putting his trust in a cornice of about 20 centimetres which ran round the outside of the building. In the haste of the moment, his nerves on edge, that idea was discarded as too risky. Mrs. Deacon claimed later that Abbé was reclining against the mantelpiece, as any innocent visitor might do. But knowing Mr. Deacon's fiery temper, it is small wonder that what he actually did was to take sanctuary behind the sofa in the salon. "Open the door at once," cried Mr. Deacon. "If you do not open the door, I will burst it in." Mrs. Deacon opened the door, dressed in her nightclothes. As soon as she saw that her husband was armed, she blew out the dressing-table candle, rushed back, and knocked the secretary's candle from his hand. Mr. Deacon noticed that the salon door was open, and when a new light had been struck, he forced his way in. He saw the shadow of a head behind the sofa. He jumped onto the sofa, put his hand on the lurking figure's shoulder, and fired 3 shots. One bullet lodged itself in the wall, another hit Abbé in the breast, and the third entered his leg. Mr. Deacon then pushed aside the sofa, seized Abbé, and addressed him in French, "There you are, I have you." Abbé, who had been trying to adjust his trousers, did not reply, but just managed to get up and stagger into the passage, where he collapsed in a pool of blood. Mr. Deacon, who remained exceptionally cool throughout, asked him if he was badly wounded. Abbé responded with a droop of the head. Then Florence seized her husband's hands, threw herself at his feet and implored him to spare her, to leave Abbé alone and to make no scandal for the children's sake. It was too late, because the shots had aroused the servants and other guests on the first floor. They all came running out until they saw Mr. Deacon, whereupon they retreated quicker than they had come. Mr. Deacon pushed his wife away and replied, "I will not shoot you for the sake of our children. I have caught you at last, and now leave you to give myself up." Simultaneously, he told Beaumont to take note of the impression of two heads on the pillows and ordered him to summon the police. He spent the remaining hours of the night at the Mary. Meanwhile, the partially dressed victim, his clothes soaked in blood, was carried to his room and attended to by Irma. A local doctor, Dr. Ascara, and Dr. Vaudremer, a physician from Paris, came to examine him and pronounced his condition to be very serious. Both Montesquieu and Prince Poniatowski wrote that Abbé was fit enough to make a new will in favour of Mrs. Deacon, and the sum of 500,000 francs was mentioned. Montesquieu also recalled that Abbé constantly cried out, somewhat unnecessarily, "I am finished." Though everything possible was done to help him, Abbé, never strong, lost consciousness at about 8 o'clock in the morning and died soon afterwards. Mr. Deacon remained in custody. That afternoon he made a statement to Dr. de Valcourt, the American vice consul. He was given the chance to prosecute his wife for adultery, but when told that this would mean that she would be taken into custody, he replied, "No, I shall not lay a complaint for the sake of my children, nor did I intend to kill Monsieur Abbé. I only wished to mark him." At all times he expressed consideration for his children, to whom he was deeply attached, and his main concern was to obtain custody of them. Mr. Deacon spent the night of the 18th at Dr. de Valcourt's house. The next morning he was conducted to Grasse by the chief commissaire, where he was put in prison. Florence Deacon began the day after the crime rather differently. She cancelled a luncheon engagement with the Princesse de Sagan. She was generally criticised for this, though Montesquieu, after parodying the incident in his poem Dea in Les Quarante Bergères, inquired, "Does disaster preclude politeness?" He concluded that at this moment of social ruin, such a gesture was not in bad taste. Boni de Castellane, that most debonair of society figures, recalled that when a society hostess heard that Abbé had not even attempted to jump out of the window, she turned to a young man and told him, "Now, my dear friend, you must learn to do gymnastics." A few days after the murder, Mrs. Deacon was given permission to go to Paris to consult friends. The children remained with Marraine Baldwin. In her apartment at the Rue de Grenelle, Mrs. Deacon made a statement to the Daily Telegraph reporter. "When I am at home, I am accustomed to relinquish ceremony, and while I went into my bedroom to put on a dressing gown, Monsieur Abbé remained in the salon. The best proof that we had nothing to be ashamed of is that he remained where he was, and his appearance, as well as mine, shows that we were simply conversing together when he was attacked in such a cowardly manner. I am aware that it has been said that I took a great deal too long to open the door of my room, but you must remember that I was in the salon, and it took me some little time to light the candle." This was a somewhat distilled version of events. Though she was given to exaggeration, and no doubt altered the story to suit the situation, Mrs. Baldwin told a different version to Mary Berenson in March 1901, who passed it on to her own mother. The gist was that she had married a dissolute madman, who had soon tired of her, had been taken up in Paris society, and that her husband had advised her to take a lover. She had fallen madly in love with Abbé. She was tormented to death by her conscience, but her worldliness prevented her getting a divorce. On the night in question, Mr. Deacon was reading in her salon when Abbé was announced. Mr. Deacon went out and got his pistol. She thought Abbé hid behind the sofa to make divorce inevitable. Mary Berenson wrote, "At any rate, he died without a word. No one stood by her. This pretty, silly lady, whose whole life was bound up in society and who was desperately in love, found herself deprived of lover and society together. Whenever she speaks of love, she weeps. She has had lots of chances to marry again, but refuses them as she still loves this man." News of the tragedy received widespread coverage in France, England and the United States. Mr. Deacon came under hostile attack in the French papers. That an American had shot a Frenchman engaged in the national sport was considered outrageous. Mr. Deacon was described as a cowardly assassin, and a change in the law relating to husbands who take lives in such circumstances was demanded. On the other hand, the large American colony in Cannes tended to be supportive of him, their code of conduct in such matters being different from that of the French. The New York Times correspondent in Cannes reported that many of the quieter class of people here considered the style of Mrs. Deacon too pronounced, though she was popular on account of her great beauty. In Newport, where Peter Parker had been well known, the activities of his grandson caused quite a sensation. The tragedy fired the imagination of Henry James, who had not forgotten that one summer afternoon shortly after their marriage, the Deacons had visited him at his home in Bolton Street, London. Now he reached for his notebook. A very good little subject for a short tale would be the idea, suggested to me in a roundabout way by the dreadful E.D. tragedy in the south of France, of a frivolous young ass or snob of a man, rather rich and withal rather proper and prim, who marries a very pretty girl and is pleased with the idea of getting her into society. I mean the world smart and fast, où l'on s'amuse, the sort of people whom it most flatters his vanity to be able to live with. James then outlined a characteristically complicated plot, though he returned to the subject as late as 1901 and urged himself not to lose sight, by the way, of the subject that I know, I've marked it somewhere as the E. Deacon subject, he never made use of it. The long, slow process of French law ground inexorably into action. Witnesses were examined, including the hotel secretary, Monsieur Beaumont. On the 27th of February, the Deacons were confronted in an exceedingly painful scene. Mr. Deacon was so affected that he had to go to bed immediately afterwards. Mrs. Deacon persisted in denying any impropriety between herself and Abbé. On the 4th of May, Mr. Deacon altered his will to exclude his wife and established a trust for his four daughters, which provided Gladys with an income all her life and was only wound up when she died. The murder trial took place on a day of stifling heat in the assize court of the Alpes Maritimes in Nice on the 20th of May. The day before the case was due to be heard, Alexandre Dumas-Fils advocated that, since the divorce law now existed in France, the days of crimes of passion were over. He maintained that husbands have only the right to repudiate wives, and that if they shed blood, they are liable to be dealt with as common assassins. The courtroom was filled to capacity, the end gallery with fashionable ladies colourfully dressed and in elegant bonnets, eager to see justice done. Mrs. Deacon was not in court pleading ill health, but a statement from her was read. She asserted that her husband was a madman and a drunkard, but claimed that she hoped he would be acquitted on account of her children. Mr. Deacon was described as tall, slim, with close-cropped hair, tinged with the silver of his 45 years and his domestic woes around the temples. He soon won the sympathy of the onlookers. He attempted to defend himself in French, but he was no linguist, and the jury struggled to understand him. He reverted to English. The lengthy proceedings had the occasional light moment, as when he spoke of Abbé. When I saw this little man wounded, I felt poignant regrets, for a man having some conscience must always regret killing another man. A storm of applause rose from the spectators. Monsieur Beaumont confirmed the imprint of the two heads on the pillows. Irma, a lady of the most professional silence, stated that she had never seen any impropriety between her mistress and Abbé. Lombard, a manservant employed by the Deacons, was more forthcoming. He confirmed Mrs. Deacon's visits to Abbé's entresol. The prosecution accepted various points, but concluded that Mr. Deacon had killed Abbé to satisfy the hatred that had rankled for 4 years. Maître de Mange rose at 6:30 p.m. to defend Mr. Deacon, stating that Mrs. Deacon had been drawn to Abbé through vanity and that Abbé's cowering was proof enough of his guilt. He spoke of the legitimate anger of an irreproachable husband who sees the honour of his children being torn to shreds. despite an address in which Demange justified his reputation for forensic eloquence and elicited applause from the spectators, the jury's verdict was that Deacon was guilty of unlawfully wounding Abbé, though without intent to cause death. The sentence of 1 year's imprisonment was followed by a barrage of hisses, groans and hootings. Mr. Deacon's brother Halston shook him by the hand and pronounced it a most unjust verdict and sentence. Meanwhile, Mr. Deacon moped the while in a somewhat grim style, repressing his feelings like a veritable stoic, yet really looking very near breaking down. Thus Edward Parker Deacon left the court for a prison cell in Nice. His last words were addressed to his brother, "Take care of the children." Chapter 3. America. Gladys and her sisters remained with their mother until on the 10th of March the public prosecutor transferred custody of the girls to Mr. Deacon, who promptly sent representatives to take them away. Mrs. Deacon opposed this decision, and the girls left after an emotional scene. Audrey and Edith went to Mr. Deacon's brother Halston, while Gladys and the baby Dorothy travelled to Genoa with Maren Baldwin. A few weeks later, Gladys and Dorothy were sent to the Convent de l'Ascension at Auteuil in Paris. Dorothy became the pet of the community, living in the care of the sisters, while Gladys began her lessons. "I so often think of you and wish you were here with me," wrote her father, as he awaited trial at the Hotel Richemont in Cannes, but he explained that she was now a young lady and must be where you may learn all that will go towards making you a good, intelligent, honest woman. He hoped she would not take after her mother. On the 2nd of April, Gladys sent news of herself to her mother. "One little line from Gladys to give you 1,000 loves and kisses, and tell you that I am very good and busy preparing for the examens, which begin on Wednesday." A sister sat beside Gladys as she wrote. She was trying hard to be very good. Her health and spirits are excellent. Before the letter was finished, Gladys's spirits got the better of her, the poor sister concluding, "Have you ever had Gladys by you when you and she were occupied in correspondence? Not a sinecure, is it?" In June, T. Jefferson Coolidge, the United States ambassador to France, responded to requests for Mr. Deacon's release by asking the French Foreign Secretary to set him free. In July, Mrs. Deacon applied in the courts to regain legal possession of her children. She failed, but it stirred Mr. Deacon into prosecuting her for adultery to ensure that he always kept them. On the 22nd of September, President Carnot granted him a pardon in celebration of the centenary of the establishment of the First French Republic. On leaving prison in September, Mr. Deacon's sole aim was to take his children to America and devote himself to their education. He wrote to Gladys, who had been on holiday at the Hotel des Reservoirs in Versailles, declaring, "I will do everything in my power that you shall be happy and not stay at the convent this winter, but have a good home. I will see you very soon." He sent Audrey and Edith to America with Maren Baldwin, thus removing them from the jurisdiction of the French courts. Mr. Deacon was granted custody of his children before the Tribunal of the Seine in Paris on the 3rd of November. Immediately, he made haste to the Convent de l'Ascension to find Gladys, but when he arrived, the Lady Superior told him that Gladys was not there. The day before had been a holiday, and Mrs. Deacon had taken Gladys out. Neither had returned. Mr. Deacon summoned the police, who searched the convent and the Deacon home in the Rue du Canal, but the mother and the kidnapped child had disappeared to some place beyond the reach of Mr. Deacon. Mrs. Deacon was hoping that if she obtained the guardianship of her children, she would maintain some footing in society. She threatened that if her husband did not stop his criminal action against her, he would never see Gladys again. The tribunal sat on the 16th and 17th of November and decreed that Gladys should be returned to the convent, where both parents would be allowed to visit her. But the case had been making headlines in the press, with the result that the abashed nuns refused to take her back. A considerable number of lawsuits were now pending. In Grasse, Mr. Deacon had sued his wife for criminal adultery. This case, if proved, would land Mrs. Deacon in prison. Mrs. Deacon had appealed in Aix, filed a divorce suit in Paris on the grounds of cruelty, and demanded custody of the children. Finally, Mr. Deacon had filed a divorce suit in New York, where they had been married. He accused his wife of having had affairs with the Prince de Poix, the Comte de la Rochefoucauld, and the lawyer, Senator Léon Renault. He announced, "The French judges have as scant regard for morals as they do for law and order." The moment a decree absolute was granted in February 1893 and custody of the three eldest children was confirmed to Mr. Deacon, all the other suits were dropped. Florence Deacon reverted to being Florence Baldwin and remained in Paris with her youngest daughter, Dorothy. Mr. Deacon and Gladys, now aged 12, crossed the Channel to England, Gladys writing to her mother, "I cannot tell you how much I feel to leave you, although I am sure it will be but for a time, as Papa tells me you are coming to see us all in America." In London, Gladys and her father stayed at the Burlington Hotel in Cork Street and explored the shops together. Mr. Deacon bought Gladys a dress, an ulster and a hat for their forthcoming voyage. On their return to the hotel, soldiers and police were keeping the crowd back because the Prince of Wales was holding a levee. "How big and clean the English soldiers look," reported the 12-year-old. Presently, they set sail from Southampton on the steamship Trave. Gladys was delighted to have a huge cabin all to herself. They arrived in New York on the 23rd of March, where a New York Times reporter was lying in wait.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.